Good? Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. My name is Kyle Forster. I'm the founder of Big Switch Networks. The three of us are on stage here to talk about some of the lessons that we learned in a very large NFV deployment altogether. This was a heck of a project. Joined by Chris Emmons from Verizon and Radesh Balakrishnan from Red Hat. We're going to go through one by one and talk a bit about the lessons that we learned over the course of the 9-month sprint for the first phase of the project. Thanks for joining us. Chris, let me turn it over to you to kick us off.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the third day of the conference, I guess. We'll jump right in here. I'll start out by just, there's a lot of buzzwords on this slide. I think what the point of this slide is really what we set out to do, and that was to build the foundation of the next-gen network for Verizon. So we wanted to have a network that to build a network that we could use across all of our locations, all of our business units, so not just wireless, not just telecom, not just our enterprise business, but across everything to leverage that, the economies of scale and the operational efficiencies that we can gain by doing that. And we wanted it to evolve in a modern way with the pace of software and everything that we're here at this conference to talk about. So how can we leverage the most modern technology to deliver the same quality network, the same reliability network, but in a more agile, cheaper, more efficient way? So we have a multi-year plan in place. Kind of the second bullet here is about the multi-year plan we have to build out the network across Verizon and to then move all of our workloads. We have a plan set up to move all of our workloads onto the infrastructure so that in the not too distant future, we'll have a fully programmable network that will enable us to innovate and experiment and heal the network and grow the network and all those kind of things in a much more, in a much faster and a much more programmable way. So this slide's kind of found the foundation for what we did. So if you start at the bottom, we said we want to embark here on this project, starting with commodity hardware and open source software. So the benefits here are obvious, right? The commodity hardware, we can drive some of the cost out of the network of the equipment that we purchase and install. The open source software, we also see an opportunity for cost there, but more importantly, we see an opportunity there to enable competition and innovation in a way that we never have in our network before. So these were key concepts to everything we wanted to do in embarking on this project. So, and then the pillars on top of that foundation that we're taking here is starting on the right, software-defined networking, virtualization, and automation. So my partners on the stage here that helped us with the first sprint of this project, as Kyle explained, Big Switch helped us out with the software-defined networking component, and then the Red Hat component for virtualization. And then on the automation side, obviously a lot of work there going on internally as we automate our processes and our procedures and get things more to that software-based model that we're looking for. Importantly, on the commodity-based hardware piece, it was important, again, that we used that hardware and that we picked our vendors in such a way to maximize that. So Big Switch was one of the key vendors we had who was capable of running on the white box hardware that we selected for our switching fabric. And it was an immediate plug and play there. They integrated great with the hardware and then also with the OpenStack software that we selected from Red Hat, my other partner on stage here. We'll go through a little bit more of the details here, and then hopefully we'll have some time for questions at the end. So I thought I'd jump to some lessons learned before we talk about the timeline of the project. So kind of the left side of the slide here, we have a funny looking airplane with the wings backwards and all that kind of stuff. That's meant to symbolize what happened? There we go. The funny-looking airplane here is meant to symbolize kind of a different way of doing something, right? So we're used to landing airplanes with wings that look normal and all that kind of stuff. But when you start talking about moving our infrastructure to a cloud-based, to software programmable, to a self-healing, all those things that we want to accomplish, that looks very different than what we're used to doing in the network. So you think about that airplane, and building that airplane is one challenge. Why does it keep doing that? Michelle, is that you? So anyway, funny looking airplane, trying to land it at an airport that's not used to seeing that funny looking airplane. So we have a network that's tried and true. We have processes and procedures and things we've done over the years that have built the most reliable network, and we can't sacrifice that. But we do want to try new things. So the point of this slide is kind of, you know, prepare the runway for things that even you're not used to seeing, funny looking airplanes, funny looking technologies, different processes and procedures, different ways of thinking. You really got to adjust yourself to be prepared to take something like this on. And that's kind of what the right side of the slide indicates. You know, the people and that make all this happen, they have to be prepared for this as well. They have to learn the new technologies. They have to be willing to challenge the status quo. They have to be willing to look at things differently. Like, yes, we don't want to sacrifice who we are or how we got where we are or the services that we provide to our customers, but maybe there's better ways to do that, and you have to be willing to kind of step outside of your comfort zone and take that on. So now I really want to move on to this slide as opposed to whatever was going on here earlier. It must be this Mac. Anyway, so from project inception, this slide's a little bit deceiving because it kind of indicates that we started in March of 2015. March of 2015 was when we kicked off in earnest with this particular deployment. There was a lot of foundational and other work that went on well before this. Lots of trials, lots of work, lots of lab work, lots of POCs, that kind of stuff, just like a lot of you in the room have probably done. But by March of last year, we said, look, we think this technology is really, really getting to the point where we can deploy it and really start to use it in production. So that's kind of the March date is, all right, guys, we've done enough playing around. Let's go figure out what we're going to build and deploy it. So roll through a couple of months of kind of final technology evaluations, looking at different vendors, looking at different options, you know, doing some final POCs, that kind of thing, just to make sure that we were sure, certain of our selections and how we wanted to move forward. It took us into the June-July timeframe where we actually locked down the design, built it in the lab, and then did all of our testing. So this is our reliability testing, our destructive testing, our load testing, all those kind of things that we did in the lab. I think Kyle's going to talk a little bit later about some chaos monkey type stuff. I mean, we really went to great extents to abuse this thing and make sure that it was going to work the way that we wanted it to work when we got it deployed in production. So then August to November, we actually deployed the hardware into the 5 data centers, as was discussed in the press release we released this week. And we had those 5 data centers ready by the end of 2015. So we're now full on into getting workloads migrated into those data centers and actually transforming our network. So kind of a parallel line to all this that you don't see is the work we were doing on the applications in parallel. So working on virtualizing the applications, getting them to run in our environment, making sure the network requirements were satisfied, all those kind of things. So altogether, you know, a very aggressive timeline, a great team of people we put together, our partners and the teams within Verizon, many of you sitting in the room here, thank you for your contributions. But we moved at light speed here and we're really moving the network along. So with that, I think I'll turn it over to...
Thanks, Chris. Good afternoon, everybody. I want to do 3 things or touch upon 3 things. Touch a little bit about what's Red Hat's approach when it comes to NFV and what's our offering, and then quickly go to talk about the 9 month of frenetic pace that Chris Simmons and his world-class team set on ourselves and what were the learnings at a high level. And then last but not the least, from a forward-looking perspective, what are the areas that we are working on to make sure that we continue to delight Chris and his team as well as have an impact together. So our approach is upstream by default or upstream first. Now, if you were to pull a random Red Hat engineer and ask them, why are you doing that? They might say, hey, that's the only thing we know, or that's the only way we have ever done software. It's important to ask and understand why we do what we do. Our approach as a product company is to make sure that we don't create any kind of lock-in, which some of the services organizations tend to create, wherein, you know, some of the customers have told me a 6x6x6 model, 6 consultants for 6 months and rinse and repeat the same thing 6 months later. Whereas our approach is to make sure that every bit of code that we write is available upstream. The second thing to ask is, okay, what is the value of doing that? The value of doing that is making sure that there is no vendor locking, because at any point in time, the source code is available. In fact, we do our best to make sure that it's documented exactly where it's available as well. But most importantly, as a product company, it helps to make sure that maintenance and being able to support implementations across the globe can be easily done, because if every customer is going to have a different forked implementation, clearly we can't scale to be able to address that because we're not in the services business. The flip side of the question is, okay, what's the risk of forking? Probably the biggest thing is the fact that you end up having technical debt, because every customer who's stuck in an island of proprietary fork is going to have a technical debt, especially in a place like OpenStack, where the pace of innovation, thanks to every one of you who's in the part of the community helping us move the needle on a daily basis, you don't want to get stuck in that island. So that, in a nutshell, is our approach in general for any problem space when it comes, you know, from a product perspective, particularly so when it comes to NFV and OpenStack as well. What is our offering in this space? There's a lot of chatter about OpenStack being an integration engine. We, you know, if you think of it as an engine, we believe it as more as an engine plus steering wheel and the wheels that are required to actually run a car, if you will, just in my attempt at real time to give an analogy. But the important thing to realize is that we are fundamentally co-engineering with Red Hat Enterprise Linux, KVM, as well as OpenStack, a solution that a customer can bring in into their environment, continue to live with it as long as the life cycle of the product, currently at 3 years, with a peace of mind that, you know, somebody's there to watch out for upgrades and patches along the way. Now, the important thing to realize is that from an NFV perspective, the innovation is not just at the OpenStack layer. In fact, the interdependency of innovation across all layers, from Linux to KVM, as well as in partnership with Intel, DPDK, libvirt from a KVM virtualization perspective, all these are moving at different paces at any given point in time. Our job as a product company is to make sure that we are taking the customer input, driving the innovation, at the same time stabilizing and giving an experience that a customer such as Verizon can deploy and live with on an ongoing basis. The second aspect I wanted to touch upon was the lessons learned from the project itself. I'm a big fan of number three. So three areas that we got feedback around. One is a set of core capabilities that we wanted to make sure are available from a deployment perspective. So clearly, there were tens of features, and I think Kyle will talk a little bit about the kind of the increase in the number of features and expectations that were placed on us as we went through the journey. The attempt here is to at least characterize the top three areas where we had to actually do something to make sure that we are meeting the project needs. So IPv6 support exists from a, you know, OpenStack perspective, but we had to make sure that from a deployment and management perspective, it surfaced in a way that's easy to deploy and manage. The second area was around SSL support from endpoint, SSL endpoint support. Again, making sure that Director, which is our deployment technology, can make it easy to roll out SSL implementation was another area that we had to work on in a truly upstream aligned manner and make sure it's in the product as well. High availability, this is a critical area because, you know, in this NFV space, there's a lot of FUD around quote-unquote carrier grade without even a standard definition of what that actually means. The good news is that, you know, between Verizon, us, and Big Switch, we agreed on the fact that it's not about some carrier grade esoteric term, but it's all about reliability, availability, and serviceability of the infrastructure that's important, right? So that being the focus, availability clearly became a key area of focus for us. Our implementation is fairly straightforward with pacemaker, CoroSync, HA proxy implementation. And we had to also make sure that, you know, we can stand up a three-node cluster with high availability from a controller perspective. We also have the option to turn on instance HA, but you know, from the deployment perspective, we're not there yet. But just to highlight the fact that the feedback that we got during the project actually helped shape the product, the fact that we are also leading contributors, be it at CoroSync level, HA proxy level, as well as Pacemaker, does help the fact that we can react to the demand from a customer perspective and make sure that we're doing it in an upstream aligned manner. So we feel very good about having met the needs here. Two more areas of feedback is one is around partner integration itself. So you know, Big Switch was after a lot of trial and successful proof of concept was chosen as the SDN provider of choice. Now, the reality is that this opportunity was the one that actually made us work closely together at two levels. Initially, it was about how do we certify and make sure that Big Switch solution is coexisting peacefully with our OpenStack platform, Red Hat OpenStack platform offering. The next step that we were challenged to was can you make sure that the serviceability of the implementation is at a level where the deployment of our OpenStack, the deployment tool director, can actually take care of integration at a much tighter level so that it's not a two parallel implementations, but one seamless implementation experience as you scale. So definitely this meant that in addition to engaging with Verizon, we also worked closely with Big Switch and Kylan as a world-class team. We're super energetic in terms of engaging with our engineering team as well as product management to not just make sure that we have a solution for Verizon, but also think through what it takes to sustain this roadmap alignment on an ongoing basis. So that was another exciting outcome out of this process. And last but not the least, and this, the third area is scale. This is an area where we're actually, as we speak, we are spending some cycles at a Dell lab to start testing scales of hundreds of nodes. Not that every implementation is going to hit hundreds or thousands of nodes, but in an environment where if it's a conceptual maximum that we are talking about OpenStack scale, that it doesn't actually behoove very well for the pushing the limit on where technology needs to be. So what we want to focus on is not only just test and prove that we can get to multiple hundreds of nodes, but also the serviceability as well as the performance that you get from multi-hundred node implementation, it continues to be meeting the SLA requirements as well as customer requirements. So this would be an ongoing area that we would be investing as well. Now, I kind of touched upon our learnings as we were in the project. The third aspect I want to touch upon is forward-looking, what are the areas that we are focused on? I could synthesize this into maybe three points. First one is there is the classical put the genie back in the bottle requirement around hyper-converged infrastructure with OpenStack and Ceph. By that I mean today we are at a point where seven nodes is the minimum footprint required to have a well-architected implementation for Ceph and OpenStack. How do we make sure that we shrink it down? Because the reality from a Verizon perspective, the requirement is that they, it's not just the data center. There are, multiple, there is Corona Lite and Ultra Lite in terms of scope of and size of deployments that are being considered. So how do we make sure that technically we can bring these elements together as an area that we are invested on, and especially an area that we are focused on from a Newton perspective now that Mitaka is out the door already. The other areas around split stack or composable role here, the driver is to make sure that there is isolation from a role perspective so that maintenance DR can be accomplished successfully. So think of it as you want to scale out the controllers by a given specific role or a service, if you will. So that's the second direction that we are focused on as well. And a third area has to do with the fact that there are different kinds of workloads that are going to be placed, which require different kind of underlying infrastructure, with bare metal on one extreme to super small, lightweight implementation with a minimal or easier to implement high availability without pacemaker dependency, et cetera. So in a nutshell, these are all areas that we would not have normally thought about if we weren't engaged in this project. And in line with our philosophy of upstream aligned innovation, we have taken all this feedback and we're working through the roadmap to make sure that come Newton timeframe, we're knocking these off the park as well as continuing to innovate on our NFV solution here. And like I had mentioned, part of the solution or critical element of the solution was partnership with Big Switch. So tell you more about that, let me invite Kyle over.
Okay. Thanks, Radesh. So I think to me one of the big things that worked here is if you see the context, and I think this was especially like last summer was really when this was to me most visible. You have a team with a big vision, right? I mean, Chris laid out for his team a big challenge and said, it's time to rise up and meet it with a whole series of new technologies and a new kind of cultural approach. So in that context, being able to grasp onto a few familiar things makes a big difference. It's my perception that one of the things that really worked over the course of this engagement, we have this metaphor called one big switch. If you're a networking professional and you're familiar with logging into a big chassis, well, everything that you used to do on a soup, in this model, you do on the SDN controllers. Whether it's CLI in or BGP out, this is a very comfortable model. Everything that you're accustomed to doing on the chassis backplane, i.e. nothing, that's what happens on the spine switches. You don't configure a spine switch. You don't add a protocol on a spine switch in this model. It acts like a chassis backplane. Everything that you're familiar with on a line card in this model, that's how the leaf switches act. You don't have separate software images on leaf switches. You plug them in and they update from the soup. You don't have to configure protocols so that line cards can talk to each other. So being able to draw on this very familiar and comfortable metaphor, in my view, explains a lot of how we were able to accelerate very rapidly with the team, make it very intuitive and easy for everybody to understand when they're swallowing, SDN software, OpenStack, NFV instances and planning coming down the pipe, and all of this going on bare metal hardware. I think one of the neat things that's very specific to NFV, NFV stresses network designs like you wouldn't believe. It puts pressure on L2, L3 designs in ways that it's our belief that only SDN can solve. It puts pressure on network designs that make this type of model very, very interesting. So when we have, in this model, we have an integrated vSwitch. When the vSwitch plugs in, the vSwitch acts like the line card. And the leaf switches to which it's attached begin acting like the chassis backplane. This, we call it P plus V integration for NFV, simplifies so many of the really, really hard routing and switching problems that show up in NFV, that this to me was one of the big reasons why we were able to accelerate through the project the way that we did. Chris mentioned resiliency. One of the things we did in preparation was this test, this Chaos Monkey test borrowed from the Netflix team. And I would say that several of the teams on your end put us through tests that were even more extreme than the Chaos Monkey testing we could do in our labs. So this we load up on a full pod with about 48,000 VMs, a mix of Hadoop workers, and traffic gen. Shoot a controller every 30 seconds, shoot a random switch every 8 seconds, shoot a random link every 4 seconds. And every software image that ever went into the Verizon lab would pass this test for half an hour before we would send the software image over. I mean, 640 component failures in about half an hour. There is no spanning tree network in the world that can withstand this kind of beating. And it's our belief for NFV, this is the new bar. I think when we talk about a culture change. There's this culture change of the, you know, kind of the, I'd say the old approach to HA in the communication provider world. And I think under this team's leadership, this was a very, very different approach. This was a much more Google-style approach. This was an approach that says, hey, a component can fail anytime, and it doesn't matter that much. The only thing that matters is that the system as a whole stays up. And it's a different cultural way of thinking. And it's incredibly important. And it was so much fun going through this cultural transition with this team that that was, at least for me, one of the really exciting parts of the project. You know, I think, as Radesh mentioned, we started with kind of five really key criteria that were a really good fit, and literally by 3 months in had a long list of the requirements. You know, this was, I think, a snapshot from June of last year of here are the set of requirements that we need in order to really deliver NFV into full production. I think somebody might have gotten a photo of my calendar there. I'm not going to go through all this, but I think one that I would highlight. This was a problem that we had solved before the engagement, but it became a really, really interesting one. How do you integrate the vSwitch and the physical switch? Right? There's a huge amount of operational and, frankly, packet performance optimizations you can get there. Do in hardware what hardware is really good at, and do in vSwitch software what vSwitch software is really good at. And what we found over the course of really loading this thing up and doing tests for NFV traffic mixes and NFV operational models was that this integration goes from being, you know, an interesting thing to an absolute must-have. It's the only way that you can get both the performance and the operational flex that you need for NFV. You know, so that I think that we've made sort of progress on before we started the engagement. It was one of the hypotheses that we had coming in and proved it over the course of the engagement. But one new thing that we really discovered, let me just point out the second bullet. This was a really interesting one. You know, when you sit there in the lab and you're trying to design product on paper, you make all these assumptions about NFV workloads that, like, hey, there's one connection model and that one will always work, right? And, or there's like some best way to connect an NFV workload into an NFV infrastructure. And that turns out to really be not true. And frankly, that's not really in anybody's control. There are a lot of different NFV vendors. They're extremely heterogeneous. They have very heterogeneous views on what their own performance requirements are, and very heterogeneous legacy code bases that they're building on. And we have to, you know, the law of physics of engineering here apply. You know, people are, you know, on the NFV side, for the most part, building from legacy code bases. So just using Open vSwitch is great for some, terrible for others. For us, our Switch Lite VX, our Switch Lite vSwitch, just using that, great for some workloads, not enough for others. Just using single attach SRIOV worked for a very small number of workloads, it didn't work for a very, very large number. Dual attach SRIOV, that creates a very interesting and hairy set of problems on the physical network, right? But it's the only option for some of the VNFs out there. And then last, a lot of the DPDK work that we're doing, you know, that's a very, very interesting one, but it's certainly not going to cover the entire galaxy of NFVs here in the short run. So if I'd kind of point out two on the slide, I'd say the technology for the P and the V is an absolute must-have, and that creates an operational, you know, a silo challenge and a silo busting challenge, which is a management challenge, and it's really hard. And the one size fits all was for us a big lesson learned that was not obvious on paper, not obvious day one until we really started doing a lot of the heavier VNF work. So let me end there, and I think we still have just a tiny bit of time for questions. Thank you.
Could you comment on your day two monitoring logging system, and what do you plan to do when you have to do upgrade to Newton or whatnot? What's your plan?
So we've got our initial set of, you ask about day two. So an initial set of tools, kind of very basic, rudimentary, to get us up and running. And then, you know, keeping with the OpenStack or the open source themes here, we're looking at what are the best and brightest opportunities to do the monitoring going forward. The whole service assurance package is a challenge. And how do we get the information out of the infrastructure and process it and react to events in the infrastructure and all. So I would say from a day two perspective, we're still evaluating and picking those tools.
And same goes for update and upgrades?
Like update and upgrades to which part?
OpenStack services, let's say.
The OpenStack services, yeah. So we've been through, in our lab environments now, we've been through many upgrades. The production part, we're still working through our first set of upgrades there.
Okay. Thank you.
If I could add to that, from an OpenStack perspective, we just released OpenStack platform version 8 last week, and that's the first version that has got in-place upgrade version to version. So 7 to 8, and then 8 to 9 when 9 becomes available. The challenge there is that we haven't gotten confidence that there'll be API stability beyond one release. So this is an area that, you know, we're looking very actively to make sure that at some point in time, we can get to N plus two as well. We're not there yet, technology-wise.
Thank you.
I think on the fabric side, we put in something very early. I mean, this is almost 3 years ago now, that you can actually upgrade the whole fabric in about the same amount of time as it takes to upgrade an iPhone. And the downside, it's like a really cool thing. The downside of that is people actually use it a lot. So you wind up getting these like speed of upgrade, and I think this is going to be true across these infrastructures. In the vendor community, we have to plan for speed of upgrade being much, much, much faster. I'm incredibly excited about the RSP8 side. I mean, that's we're creating the capability for people to be much more agile in this area.
Thank you. It's really interesting case study, and I could not imagine in just 6 to 7 months' time you guys have achieved so much. One quick question, DPI and GTP related scenarios is, I think, pretty complex to handle in virtualized scenario. So what was your learning on that?
I'm going to have to pass on that one. I don't know, honestly. I'm not the network guy. I'm the guy that runs the team with all the smart people on it. So okay. I don't have the answer to that off the top of my head.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Across some of the early performance tests, you find a lot of the default OpenStack stuff and kind of default L2, L3 networking is very tied to TCP. So we actually had to do GTP optimizations at the spine for GTP hashing, at the leaf, and even down at the vSwitch to vNIC GTP hash.
Thank you. It's a very good presentation. I was wondering which are the specific NFE use cases which are being deployed in production. When you're talking GDP, is it really the EPC use case, or are you looking at something else too?
So I'm not going to comment specifically on what we're deploying right now. That's not part of what we're ready to announce at this point. But I will tell you that we are looking at our entire directional network. So that includes EPC, it includes IMS, it includes VoLTE, it includes all of those things. So we will be solving all of those workloads in the coming weeks and months and years.
Thank you.
I think there are several sites for the OpenStack site, and how many controller sets control those sites? I mean, the.
Sure, I actually meant to comment that in my section, so thank you for bringing that up. We, at each site right now, we have one control infrastructure. We've deployed a pod approach, so we're deploying individual pods at each location and then connecting that into the data center network. So our intention is to deploy pods at the scale we can support today, which is about 14 racks in one pod. That'll evolve to larger pods as we go, but then we'll just replicate that pod infrastructure, and each pod infrastructure will have its own OpenStack control plane.
So in other words, it's each pod kind of independent.
Independent at the controller level, yes, yeah. But then we're using higher level orchestration and coordination techniques to work across those pods, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
You mentioned that the data centers you're setting up is for your whole company. Are you planning on, is Verizon planning on moving any of its telecom services to this network?
Telecom services, you mean the wireline component, or you mean just in general? Or,
like I'm not sure I understand the question. The wireless side.
Yeah, so again, we built one infrastructure here for Verizon as one company. So we're going to serve workloads for the entire company out of these locations. So those five locations are just the first five. There's multiple locations that are coming after that. And each location, each application will be evaluated for where it needs to be based on latency characteristics, things like that. We'll place those loads that, where they best will function in the infrastructure. But we will serve all of the business units within Verizon from this infrastructure.
Thanks, everyone.